economic activities are highly interdependent. Farmers produce the goods, farmers produce as the crops, such crops like as a sugarcane, and sell to a sugar mill. If the farmers refuse to sell sugarcane to them, then they will have to shut down their mill. So the industrial sector or a secondary sector is dependent on a primary sector. If industry refuses to buy the sugar cane from the farmers, then the farmers will have to bear the heavy losses. The prices of a sugar cane will fall. In such condition, the prices of sugar, it will be as a high. So both primary and secondary, these two are the interdependent. Same as a tertiary sector, also interdependent on a primary and a secondary sectors. So there are a large number of goods and services are produced in all the three sectors. Numerous people are engaged in various activities of production. Now the question arises here, how much goods and services are being produced to each sector? How much goods and services are being produced in each sector, and how many people are engaged in each sector? How many total number of people they are engaged in each sector? So this is not possible to count that the how many total number of people they are engaged in a different number of economic activities, different number of activities. So because there are the hundreds and thousands of the goods and services are being produced daily in each sector, it is almost impossible to count and add up each and every item being produced. This task is huge and not possible. To tackle that problem, the economists have suggested that actual numbers of items of goods should not be counted and added up. Instead, the value of final goods it should add up in a national income. The value of a final value means as a after selling the earnings, the money which has generates. Clear? So the value of a final goods and services should be used. National income includes only as a final goods, not as the intermediate goods. Final goods only. So final goods, yesterday we discussed regarding them. Final goods, all those goods which are meant either for consumption by the consumers, or either used for increasing the production through the investment. So for investment by the firms are called as a final goods. So they are finished goods meant for the final use. It is important to know that the final use of a product is available for a consumption of a consumers. Or investment. These are not resold and nor they enter into the further stages of production. Further stages means the refinement. For example, when the raw cotton, it is purchased by the cotton textile mill, the owner of a cotton textile mill, what they generally do, they are go through that particular cotton through the different processing stages, ginning, spinning, weaving, dyeing, cutting, stitching. So all these are the processing stages. Afterwards, when that particular cotton cloth, which is ready-made cotton cloth, which is ready to sell, that particular good has includes under the GDP. That is the final good. Clear? Ginning, spinning, weaving, all these are the processing stages, manufacturing stages or processing stages. These are not, their value has not includes under the GDP of the country. Clear? Only as a final goods are included under the GDP of economy. So all goods purchased by the consumer households are final goods because they are meant for final consumption. All goods purchased by the firms for the investment for further processing or resale are the final goods. Remember that the consumers acquire the goods for consumption, whereas the firms are purchasing the goods for the increasing production. So these are the final goods. Now the intermediate goods. intermediate goods, intermediate goods are generally all those goods which are meant either for further production or for resale in same year are known as the intermediate goods. I'm repeating again, intermediate goods are all those goods which are meant either for further production. For further production means processing of a materials. Raw cotton has used for the processing till the ready-made garments. Then the for resale in the same year are known as the intermediate goods. Goods for further production means they are used to produce other goods and they move from one stage of production to the another. Or a manufacturing of a final product. So raw materials and a semi-finished goods are generally the intermediate goods. There is the one example. Example, building, residential building is a final good. And for the construction of a building, residential building, brick, cement, sand, all these are the intermediate goods. So the value of the intermediate goods are not included in a GDP. Only the final price, final value of a good is only included under the GDP of economy. Why? Because already the final goods having as the value of all those intermediate goods which purchased by the person for the construction of a building. Another example is there. In bakery owner manufacture the biscuits. So for the manufacturing of a biscuit, it require as a milk, wheat flour, yeast. So all these materials, their value already includes under the value or the price of the biscuit. So that's why only as a final goods are includes under the GDP of economy, not as the intermediate goods. Its reason is that the value of the intermediate goods is already included in the value of final goods when these are converted into the final goods. Means cotton cloth, that particular denim jeans or other ready-made garments, they are having as the value of all those inputs, all those materials which were purchased for the manufacturing of that particular ready-made garment. Their value already includes under it. Clear? If we calculate the intermediate goods or final goods both in a GDP, then it will be as a double counting. Under such circumstances, the per capita income, it will be show as a higher. But as compared to the conditions, it is lower. Actually, per capita income is a lower existed in a country, but because of a calculating in a intermediate and a final goods, it will be as a higher. So that's why to solve that problem, we are only includes the final goods in GDP of country. Clear? Final goods in GDP of country. So GDP. So there are two of the terms, GDP and a GNP. GDP stands for the gross domestic product. Gross domestic product. domestic product. Gross domestic product. It means the value of final goods and services produced in a particular year in each sector provides the total production of the sector for that particular year. I'm repeating again, the value of final goods and services, the value of final goods and services produced in a particular year in each sector provides the total production of the sector for that year. So the sum total of a country, it is the value of all final goods and services produced within a country. And measuring of a GDP is done by the central government. Central government is responsible for the calculating the GDP of country. Two different agencies are there: CSO, Central Statistical Organization. Central Statistical Organization. Central government is responsible for the calculation of GDP through the CSO. For this, economic surveys conducted by the government. Economic surveys conducted by the government. Clear? This is as the GDP. Next is the GNP, gross national product. Gross national product. National product. Gross national product. Gross national product. So gross national product. So what is this? That gross national product. It includes GNP includes the value of all goods and services. All goods and services. Gross national product includes all goods and services. All goods and services. Produced within a country as well as net income earned from abroad, means those individuals which gone towards other countries, US, Canada, England, Dubai, other countries for their earnings, for their livelihood. They earn from such countries but spending in our country. So their value, their income also includes under the GNP. Their income also includes under the GNP. Clear? GDP only includes as the value, final value of all goods and services produced within a country. Whereas a GNP, gross national product, includes as a value of all goods and services within a country as well as net income. Net, N-E-T. Net income earned from abroad. Income earned from abroad. Because such individuals, these are also the assets of our country. They are also the assets of our country. Their income, earned income, also includes under the GNP. Clear? Central Statistical Organization, Princi. Central Statistical Organization. CSO stands for the Central Statistical Organization. Central Statistical Organization. Central Statistical Organization. While the GDP only includes the value of a domestically produced goods. Domestically, within a boundary, whatever the goods and the services which are produced by the country, all their value has only includes under the GDP, and it also includes as an income earned from the abroad. Income earned from abroad, as well as income which that income which is generated with the production of a goods and services within a country is a GNP. Clear? This is asked the difference between or an interrelation of a final goods and a intermediate goods. Final goods and intermediate goods. Now the next part has the historical change in sectors. Growth of a sectors in a given passage of time. Since last 70 years of independence, the growth of each sector. Historical change in sectors. When India is declared as an independent country, at that time, our economy, it was not as a in good condition. For this, in 1950, the Planning Commission set up by the Government of India, for the sectoral growth. Sectoral growth means each sector. Turn-wise, growth of sectors. Sectoral growth targeted by the government with the help of a planning commission, which was set up in 1950. Afterwards, government initiated the five-year plans. Till present, 12 five-year plans and 4 annual plans initiated by the government of India for the sectoral growth of economy. In a first five-year plan, it targeted on agriculture, means primary sector. First 2 decades, till the time of 2 decades, government only targeted towards the primary sector, the growth of a primary sector. Then it moved towards some manufacturing secondary sector. And at the age of 1970s to 80s, government started to invest in a growth of a tertiary sector, service sector. That's why afterwards 2000, the telecommunication services, they improved. Telecommunication services, it improved in our country. So during the process of economic development, as a result of the impact of investment in the production of various sectors, the relative importance of different sectors and subsectors likely to undergo a change. This is referred to as a structural change. Government started to invest money in a different parts of the sectors, which is known as the structural change. Structural change. It means that government not directly invest the money in a growth of a complete sector. It started to invest money in a different parts of a sector. It means first they targeted towards the agriculture, then growth of the forestry, then growth of a dairy farming, fishing. So turn wise. So when the government investing as their sources, financial sources for the growth of the different parts of the sectors is known as the structural change. That is known as the structural change. In other words, a structural change studied in terms of the contribution of different sectors and subsectors. I'm repeating again, a structural change studied in terms of the contribution of different sectors and subsectors is the variation over time as a result of economic development. So as economic growth gathers momentum and the share of the manufacturing and service sectors improve, that of the agriculture declines. At the first 2 decades of afterwards the independence of our country, government emphasized over the primary sector for the growth of the agriculture. Then afterwards, when the investment moved towards the secondary sector and the tertiary sector, then the growth of a primary sector declines. Why? Because job opportunities provided by the service sector and industrial sector, job opportunities provided by the tertiary sector and secondary sector. Net national income can be broadly divided into the income emerging from the commodity sectors, agriculture, mining, manufacturing, and small enterprises, and income emerging from the service sector, like as commerce, transport, banking, insurance, communication, and other services. The percent share of different sectors, primary, secondary, and tertiary sector, is the net national income. Net national income, or a national income of industrial origin. It is also called as a percentage of net national income by the kind of economic activities. Is that clear? Economic activities. During the span of the year, 70 years of the Indian independence, three sectors, these were contributed in economy as the differently. For example, 60% of our job opportunities directly generated by the primary sector. But the share of a primary sector in GDP of our country, it was as the less than the 20%. Less than 20%. Then government started to invest in a secondary sector where the agro-based industries set up. Agro-based industries, cotton textile industries, jute mills, such kind of agro-based industries set up by the government of India, to which the product which produced by the primary sector, it consume in agro-based industries and provide job opportunities. It provide job opportunities. Clear? So the economic growth brings about the structural changes in the economy of the country. So there is a shift in the relative significance of different sectors, primary, secondary, and tertiary, in the incomes, in the income of the country. For example, in a primitive economy, before of the Britishers or during the British age, primitive economy, agriculture is the only source of the livelihood for the members of the economy. The whole of its income originates in the agricultural sector. So as the economy develops, it shows signs of change in the relative significance. As the economy develops, such changes, they appeared in agriculture simultaneously with the other sectors of economy also. It does not imply that the agriculture loses its importance. It simply means that other sectors become equally, if not more important, thus affecting the relative importance of the sectors. As you read that the most number of developed economies are basically emphasizing over secondary and tertiary sectors only. They are less emphasized over the agriculture sector because of there is a vast scope for the growth of economy to the secondary and tertiary sector. That's why the government has changing their emphasis from a primary towards secondary and now tertiary sector, where the job opportunities are the more, which will consume that workforce which now presently gone towards the other countries of the world. Clear? This was as the historical growth of different sectors of Indian economy. Till there any doubts, any questions? So rising importance of the tertiary sector in production. So in last 70 years of independence, the tertiary sector, it improved. The question arises, what is the service sector? So we know that the dependent in the economy of a country depends upon the level of rate of growth. The progress and prosperity of a country depends upon the development of its agricultural and industrial sectors. But these sectors need services and facilities like energy, power, transport, telecommunication, roads, ports, water supply, marketing, banking, insurance, technical training institutes, etc. So for their proper functioning, without energy like electricity and power, the industrial production is not possible to for the uninterrupted power supply as essential for the industry. Trade is also not possible without the facility of road, rail, waterways, and other means of transport. Industries need the finance for the working capital and the agricultural growth. For this, the banks are providing as the credit as a loans. Banks providing as a loans or a credit for the growth in industries and agricultural sector. So banking and insurance facilities cannot be provided without means of communication, skilled and trained personnel and workers for industrial and agricultural sectors. It cannot be produced without the schools, colleges, and technical training institutes. So we cannot have the efficient and healthy manpower without the existence of medical and health facilities. So for the better housing and sanitation facilities are required for the good health of the population of any economy. We can say that as the facilities or the services of power, energy, transport, communication, banking, insurance, marketing, etc., all these are the services of an economy. So what is the role? The question arises here, what is the role of the service sector in India? Service sector provides as the basic services for the growth of a human resource. First, service sector provides the basic services for the growth of a human resource. Second one, it is helpful. Service sector is helpful in the development of agricultural and industrial sectors. Third, new services based on information and communication are essential for present economy. Fourth, more and more services are provided to the hotels, restaurants, tourism, shipping, and private schools. Fifth, it provides the better opportunities for employment. And sixth one, doctors, lawyers, accountants, teachers, IT engineers, they all render the services which are equally important in the development of the country. So all these are playing the important role for in an economy. The service sector through them provides as the important role in economy. It's not a structural change, it's a structural, yes, change, C-H-A-N-G. It's a structural change. Structural change means the growth of a different parts of the sectors or their subsectors. Growth of the different sectors and the subsectors is a structural change. Why? Because primary sector not possible to grow as the completely, for which the government initiates for the growth of the different parts of that particular sector. For example, the growth of agriculture, green revolution initiated around the 1960s, 70s. Green revolution. To solve the problem of credit in agriculture, government initiated a different number of schemes are there. There are the subsidies are given by the government for the purchasing of agricultural appliances. Second one, as a Kisan credit cards are there. Kisan credit cards are there on which, on the basis of agriculture land of a farmer, government or government with the help of a banks, it lend a money, some amount of money to that money, which can be used by the farmer for their different needs of their families, for their agriculture and the family needs. It can use as that much of a money which has given in the form of a loan through Kisan credit card. Such kind of facilities, they are charged as a low interest rate. The role of a cooperative societies for growth of rural economy. So government targeted the different parts of a sectors. When the growth of a sectors or a subsectors of a economy by the investment, more investment is known as a structural change. That is known as the structural change. Clear?